Hello friends, you're with the Lonesome Gamer, and I'm playing Assyrian Wars. We've been now through the first turn, and we also did the first interface. Assyria is in the lead with 11 points, Babylon follows with 4, and Elam and the Medes have 1 point, Egypt is at 0. I'm not sure if the Assyrians can be really happy with the result of the first turn. I think usually they are doing better during the first turns, but okay, we'll see if that will be enough in the end to win the game or not. At the moment, especially for Elam, the situation looks grim. They have lots of Assyrian troops in their areas. They have lots of these pillage markers, which actually led to an economic disadvantage. And I'm not sure if they can hold on much longer against a conquest of the Assyrians. Up here, the Cimmerians showed up, and they're gonna try to conquer Urartu during this turn, so we'll see how they will do. The Persians have a pretty strong force here, and they are at war with the Medians, and, well, this is also going to be an interesting conflict. We're going to see here how the Egyptians will do sieging Gaza. They managed to destroy the garrison there, but there are still strong forces, strong fortifications, so that is also not going to be that easy. After I did the first turn in a lot of detail, and it took me, I don't know, I think 6 videos to do it, from now on I'm only going to focus on the highlights of the game and show more the overall picture. And well, I try to, I think the goal should be to do one turn in 2 videos. I think that's a reasonable goal. It would be great to do a turn in a single video, but I'm not sure if I can do that. We'll see about it. Okay, so the last impulse did Babylon, so the next one will be Elam. And but before we start, we gotta initiate the turn exactly. And what we do here is we gotta remove all the mercenaries. They go all away except for the Assyrian mercenaries. Assyria can rehire them. And then each country will get a mercenary pool. The miners, one mercenary, the powers 4, and Assyria 8, minus the one they now rehired. So there won't be more than 8 mercenaries on the board for them. Okay, so I gave the mercenaries to the powers. The Assyrians were not that lucky. These guys are not that great. They kept a few better ones. The Mede ones are okay, I guess. Egypt is also not lucky, but they still have the Arabs here. Babylon's fine, more or less. And really lucky was Elam with these 3-4 strength units. That might help them quite a bit. Urartu ended up with one, with a bowman, and the Persians also ended up with a bowman. And now we see an interesting part here. We see now the conquest check, the tribute checks. And we start with the Phoenicians. Now they have 4 dice here. So it's easily possible that they will not pay. Let's see. If there's a 6, they do not pay. And it seems that they do. Yep. So they pay. That's kind of unlucky. That means the eco marker goes down to 0. And they pay a tribute. No, that's not true. They only pay 1 tribute. Minors pay 1, majors pay 2. So therefore their eco marker is at 1. Okay, then we see Israel. And they will pay because they are conquered. And there is still this grace period. So they pay. The eco marker goes to -1 because they don't even have 3 cities anymore, because one is a province. So that means they generate now a negative income, and that will probably lead to the point where they are no longer able to pay tribute after 2 impulses, because they're simply bankrupt. Judah, well, we got a roll for Judah with 3 dice. And they don't pay. That's interesting. They refuse to pay, so they gain a special marker for that, which goes here. And it means that the Assyrians have to punish them. That might not be so easy, because they got to march down here. I mean, okay, it shouldn't be such a big deal. But maybe there'll be some conflict with the Egypt then. Syria was conquered, so they have to pay. Oh, wait a minute. Actually, the Assyrians are now at 1 tribute. This should be a 0. There should be these. Okay. And yeah, the Syrians have to pay, so that means that their marker goes down 1 space. This thing goes right in here, and that marker goes up another space. Urartu was conquered, so they also have to pay, and that also brings them into a negative income now. That goes up another space. The Phrygians. Yeah, there was the secret diplomacy action by Assyria, which also forces the Phrygians to pay. Uh,
Okay, there we are.
The Persians always pay. Wow. And so that means the only one who's not paying for now is Judah. But we have some other tributes. The Phoenicians, no, the Persians pay tribute to Babylon. So that means this goes down to zero. That one is flipped onto the plus side. And the Babylonians gain an additional one. Okay, then we have these cities here. They also pay tribute. So two cities for Elam. That means they gain two additional points. And I gotta do this with the tribute markers here. They gain one. They gain... shit. One, two, three, four, five, six tribute, if I'm not mistaken. Cyprus pays tribute to Babylon. Okay. Tzatzikia pays tribute to the Medes. Also at nine, that's not bad. And finally, Adana pays tribute to Assyria, which brings them up to 19. That is definitely impressive. Okay, so that was then the tribute phase, and Judah is the one to be punished, I guess. So, Elam, they used a pretty good card for the points, 6 points, hired some mercenaries, some pretty good mercenaries actually, and they wanted to attack the small force which besieged Ize. The Assyrians managed to evade. First they tried to play the turncoat cards, which would have brought some mercenaries on their side. The Assyrians played the countermeasures against that card, which cancelled that card. The Elamites played that countermeasure card. So then the Assyrians tried to evade. Problem was that this took a card from another card of Elam, so they are now left with a single card. But now when I think about that, I guess the evasion actually should not have been possible, because I think you have to decide to do an evasion before you play the battle cards. So in this case, there should be a battle, and I'm going to do that. So the Assyrians are in a pretty weak, have a pretty weak force, but this is a mountain area, so that gives them two additional points, and they have a good leader, and they have their special additional die for the standing army, so they're not in such a bad shape. I'm actually thinking about using my chariots as bow units. They only have a value of 3 because it's a mountain area. Now let's see. First we go with this guy here, or the 2. That is a hit. That's cool. Now the other guy uses this also as a bow unit, his chariot, so they can cancel one hit of the bowman. Oh shit, my chariot's missed, so that means no hits here. And now My heavy unit is attacking. Oh, great. These are two hits because it's a two and it's a heavy unit. And another one for the leader. That's a miss. So that is not exactly looking great for the Elam. What about the Assyrians? The heavy unit was a miss. The chariot also screwed up. And then we have six dice. Wow. We have six dice for the mountains, the leader, and the Assyrian bonus. And we have indeed four hits. So that means the Assyrians win that battle. That unit is lost. And the other guys take two more hits. And by the way, hits have to be distributed equally between regulars and mercenaries. And I'm pretty sure I messed this up until now. So I think, or I'm going to try to get to remember this. So that means Assyria stays here. And we also see a route. Actually, we see two routes. So these two mercenaries will route, which sucks because it will allow probably the Assyrians then to hire these mercenaries. That is very, very painful here. So that was a pretty bad situation now. Urartu positioned a few units up here, and now it's the Persians. And they are now controlled by Assyria because they are at war with the Medes, which are in the rebel camp. So the Persians will play that card. And, yeah. Although I'm not sure if they can afford to do that. I wanted to play that card for the event, but it costs me six. I only have an income of zero, so it probably makes no sense at all to play that card as an event. And it doesn't seem fair to to go to depth here. I'm not even sure if this would be allowed. So in this case, I'm not going to do it because I cannot repay in the next impulse. So I'm going to take the 6 points instead. And I'm pretty sure I can do an attack here. Okay, so the Persians did this attack here against Ecbatana. And they have a decent force here. So, well, we'll see what happens. I think they are a little stronger than the Medes, but these guys have the mountain bonus. So let's start the attack. We have two bowmen here, one with a strength of two. That's a miss, and the other one with a strength of four. So we have one bow hit here. The other guys have one, two, three bowmen. One with a strength of two. And the other two with a strength of three. Okay, so that's also a hit. It means now everybody now takes one hit. Okay. And now we'll see the melee battle. So we have One light calf with a strength of 2. That's a miss. We have 1, 2 light calf with a strength of 3 plus 3 battle dice. So 5 dice here for the Persians. Wow, that's not bad. 3 hits. And then we have the heavy cavalry. And these are 2 more hits because it's a heavy unit. So that was painful. 5 hits plus 1 bow hit. I guess the Medes will lose that battle. I'm not even sure if they could win it. So we see first the light infantry. That was a miss. We have 1 light cavalry plus 2 for the leader plus 2 for the mountains, means we have 5. And that wasn't bad, but still not good enough. Only 3 hits. So that means the Medes lose that battle. They will, in addition, take 2 routes. And these guys managed to capture this. Well, we see, maybe they will retreat into the city. We're gonna see about that. Now let's take the losses and then we'll see. Okay, as expected, the Medes retreated into the city of Ecbatana, which is a fortress, only a level 2 fortress though, so it's not that strong. The Persians could try an assault, but I think that is pretty risky. Oh no, wait a minute, I forgot about the routes. So then it might be actually a good idea to do an assault. 2 units will rout. On the Median side. So then an assault could be an option. It would allow the Medians to roll, well, a lot of dice. I don't know, 10 or 12 dice. Usually they would have 2, 3, 4, 6 dice, so they could roll 12 dice. I think that's not the greatest idea. So I think we're going for a hunger siege here. We could also try a standard siege. I mean, these are bowmen. Hard to tell. I think I'm gonna try. I don't know, actually. I'm gonna go for a hunger siege. I think that makes the most sense. It will take a while, but it might be worth it. So for now, we're gonna place that here, and in the next turn, we can place it then on, in the next impulse, we can place it on that city. Okay. Okay, now I want to show the activation of the Cimmerians. And the way this works is they draw a card. They never play the event. They gain the points. So 5 points for them. Then they're gonna pillage the area here. And now they can use their points to move their forces and hire reinforcements. And basically the goal is clear. It was written in the campaign sheet. We have to destroy Urartu. So we're simply going to take as much units as we can. And well, we can only, we still have to be careful because we have to divide the armies into two, and then we can attack this area. And well, let's see. If this guy goes first, we will not see an invasion. So maybe that's an evasion, an automatic evasion. So maybe that's an advantage for the Sumerians. And then I'm not going to do this battle there in detail. I'm pretty sure Urartu will lose. And then we're probably going to see a siege against Tushpa, maybe even an assault attempt. We'll see about that. First, let's move the army in there. Okay, so the Cimmerians tried to besiege Tushpa, but they failed. They tried a standard siege and not an assault. The reason for that is they cannot combine into a single army and do the assault as one strong force. Because, yeah, they got these are simply two armies and they have no army group card, so they cannot build an army group. And therefore, there is there is a limit there on how many units can attack that city. And it's going to be very hard for them to get Tushpa. Well, they could, of course, try a hunger siege, but that would take a long, long time. But I might consider that in the next turn. I'm not sure, though. I don't know if this is going to happen. We'll see about that. Okay, I really doubt it. Okay, the next, so we're basically done with this impulse round. See now Assyria next, and I'll be back if something interesting happens. So we start with the Assyrian impulse, and they play that nasty little card, Changed Plans. Discard this card to exchange one non-home card in your hand against one non-home card that one of your allies has in hand. You may inspect your ally's hand before choosing the card to be exchanged. This does not require your ally's consent. I think that's kind of cool. So I'm going to give the Babylonians the fire ships, and in return I'm not going to take any alliance, which allows me to move any one marker 2d6 steps on the diplomatic track. That is definitely a good card, and yeah. Now, the Assyrians have a massive income of 19, and I guess what they're going to do first is they're going to try to restore or rebuild their damaged units. These suckers here. Yeah, okay. And then maybe hire a few more of these mercenaries. And then I think I'm going to simply continue here my campaign in Elam. And of course I have to pay for all these units here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Because I already pillaged there. But I can pillage here. Okay, so I gotta pay 4. We're seeing an impulse round where everybody is kind of recovering from the losses of the last turn. Everybody has new mercenaries available, so they're kind of healing, recruiting mercenaries, and so on. Assyria basically did nothing. This hunger siege went on, and in the next turn they can't take the city, so the people of Susa have to do a sortie if they don't want to simply all die. The Medes. Well, the funny thing is that now I kind of
the Medes as well as the Assyrians, they all forgot about this revolt marker. And I did too. There should be a revolt marker up here. And I removed that for some reason, and now I cannot find a marker. Yeah, and they both missed to enter these spaces, so that was pretty stupid of them. But they find another opportunity to do it now. Everybody or most of the people also disbanded some a unit to get an additional economy marker. The Medes played their gathering the tribes, which was pretty expensive but gives them a massive economical boost. It's the Babylonians now. And by the way, nobody, well, the Egyptians could have maybe, I don't know. I thought about selling the Egyptian army group card, but we might face a war with the Assyrians because they want to punish Judah, so maybe it's a good idea to keep that card. Now, the Babylonians have the Sumerian alliance, and they might play that. I think it would be pretty awesome if we could have an alliance with these guys, because when they have destroyed Urartu, we could turn against Assyria, and that would be just amazing. So let's see. 2d6. That's okay. 7. So it's Babylon. They go up here. Okay. That costs them 4 points. Brings them to 11. And, you know, there is this stalemate here. I'm still not sure what to do here. I probably don't want to risk an attack on this army here of Sennacherib. But I might considering moving around, maybe attacking this army here of the Assyrians. But then Babylon, of course, is open for an attack. But it will be hard to take. So maybe I could leave, I don't know, 2 or 3 bowmen in here. If the attack comes, we might see an automatic evasion. That sounds like a good plan. I think I'm going to go for that. Maybe I hire a few units before. Still got some points left. So yeah, I think that's something I want to do. Okay, so this is interesting. Nabopolassar is now moving with his army here to Nippur, and Sennacherib is trying to intercept. Let's see. So basically we need a 7. What? 7 plus. Okay, and then the dire is modified. So 7 plus minus 1 is, we need an 8. But this guy has a 4, so he only needs a 4. What about the mobility ratings? Okay, he's got, oh man, it looks like, I don't know, actually. Hard to tell. Let's see what he rolls. If it's getting close, we might check the mobility rating too. But I don't think it doesn't make a big difference. Okay, there is no question here. He can do this interception. And I think he leaves one behind. He crosses a river. Although I'm not sure, I think during an interception there are no terrain modifiers, but I gotta check that. Okay, now we As I thought, there are no terrain modifiers during interception. The Egypt... No, they're not allowed to play that current. Shit. Okay, I think nobody has really interesting battle cards. Well, we could play a rally. Ignore routes in one combat. I don't know if that's so great. Escape route. This is definitely one of the coolest cover arts in this game, maybe in a war game in general. It looks awesome. You may ignore the route results of a battle you have lost. So I think I can keep this card and use one of these. Okay, so let's do the battle. Sadly, no one else can play a battle card. Only the people who are actually involved in a battle. Otherwise, someone would help the Babylonians here. But we see. I mean, I think they're not doing that bad. They have a pretty good force. If it's enough, we'll see. Wow, this is gonna not be easy. That's gonna be a close battle. Let's see. Do they wanna? They might say, "Hey, I'm throwing in one of these special home cards." That could be worth it here, and I'm not sure if I need it at all, but it's hard to tell. It's really hard to tell. This is a pretty... I might play that card. Run of combat. I think the Assyrians will play this card. God Ashur demands holy war. All Assyrian regulars... units gain +1 to their combat factors in this land battle or siege. Does affect leader and bonus dice. So that is extremely powerful. We're going to play that. Costs us 6 points that we'll have to pay back. What the fuck is that? Why are there 9 points? Oh, I might have messed up something. Shit. I don't remember why I placed these 9 points there. Damn, what did I do? 9 points is a lot. Ah, yeah, I remember. I think I paid for the mercenaries. And I forgot to reduce that during the first impulse round. Shit. Okay, whatever. So, then I'm not gonna allow these guys to play that card because I did now the first impulse round without reducing their income by these 9. I really should remember that. I'm gonna play that here. Hope I remember. Maybe I'm gonna place it here next to the eco marker so that I remember it. Might be a good idea. Okay. And, well, let's do the battle then without this special card. I think they still have a good chance here. But they would have had to pay all this. They could not have improved all their units here. So I think that kind of evens out here. Now, first let's do the bow phase. And there are these bowmen here. And I think in this case, they will act as heavy units. So they can actually cancel out because they have five heavy units. They can cancel out 2 hits of the bowman. So, oops, shit. Great. Okay, let's see. First one with a 2. Okay, the other ones doesn't matter. They will be canceled anyway. So already it's looking bad for Babylon. They have these 2 light infantry. That's a hit. I'm By the way, they have... Babylon has 2.5 points left. Then they have... 1, 2, 3, 6 dice with 3. That was awesome. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Fantastic. Absolutely amazing. That brings them to 6 hits. And then they have a heavy unit with a 3. That was a miss, sadly. And then we have the other heavy unit with a 4. And yes, these are 2 kills, 8 hits. That's amazing. Now, that's something that the Babylonians have to... that the Assyrians have to counter. But they still have a good chance. So we have... Oh, I forgot to do the bowman here. And that was a miss anyway. Now we got... 1 light infantry, which hits. Okay, we got 1, 2. Now, these are the 2 heavy infantries with a die of 3, and one of them is a hit. Okay. Then we got 4 dice, 5 battle dice because of the leader and the bonus. And that was not so good. That's only a single hit. That was a pretty important roll now. I think that might have lost the battle for the Assyrians. Now what is left? Well, they still got 4 units, 4 chariots. 3 chariots actually. Let's see. Oh wow, that was good. 4 hits with 3 chariots. That was amazing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Still, it's not enough. They don't win the battle. Okay. So, I'm gonna assign all the hits and then we'll be back after results. Okay, so that's the situation. The Assyrians took heavy losses. They've lost their 2 mercenaries' chariots. For the Babylonians, it wasn't so bad. They had some better choices to make. They could assign 3 hits to their mercenaries, so they lost only 1 chariot and could take 1 hit with this guy and the other ones for some light cav. But for the Assyrians, it was a little more painful. Now, the Assyrians are going to play the escape route. You may ignore the route results of a battle you have lost. You can now simply move back. To Deluran. But in the end, you know, it wasn't that terribly bad. Still, because it was no overrun, this force here in Nippur has to stop now. And yeah, they cannot move on. They still have 2.5 points left, so they might say, yeah, I'm gonna spend 1 point to flip this sucker. And it's also kind of tempting to it's expensive and I don't know if I can afford that. I'd love to bring a raider into the raid box, but I need my units here now. So I think I cannot afford to do that. So what do I want to do? I think I'm going to hire another bowman here. And place him also here in Nippur. pretty sure I can await another attack by Zenmach Erib in the next turn, or in the next impulse. And because that was quite a nice battle, it gives me a victory point. Should not forget about that. So now it's the Elam and well, we'll see what they're gonna do. They have a problem now here, obviously. Zuza is probably gonna fall, which sucks. Okay, Urartu, I think they just had a single point or something. They bought a unit from the regroup box. The Persians continued with their hunger siege of Ecbatana, and they did heal some units. And that was also their last card, so there is not a lot they can do in the future except for continuing this hunger siege. And we'll see how it goes there. Okay. And now it's the Sumerians. The Sumerians managed to bring down the walls of Tushpa by one level, which is not so bad. But they took some losses in exchange, so I'm not sure if they can. I really doubt that they can do a successful siege there. It's a very tough city. Now we're done with this impulse round again, and I think this time I'm going to load it up. And hope to see you on the next video or on lonesomegamer.com. Bye.